We live in amazing times, times where superhumans are among us, and nowhere is that better to be seen nowadays than at the Paralympics. What was amazing at the last Paralympic Games, they were sold out in London, and through bionic technology, we are simply re-enabling the disabled so much that even they are accused of having unfair advantage. So this is not fiction. This is here. But it hasn't always been like that. There are only like 20, 30 years where people thought about prosthetic devices in this way. They saw wooden sticks, and that was really the image, at least when I entered this industry. And now it's moved over to this. Sarah Reinhardsen, good friend of mine, who completed the Ironman in 2005 in a little bit over 16 hours. She's amputated above the knee. Yes, truly amazing. Even here locally, Lacey Henderson took the stage here with me 2 years ago. She's a local at the DU and graduated, I think, 2 years ago, and is a Paralympian. This development started with inventors, including Van Phillips from Southern California, and others from Iceland, Sweden, and beyond. They have created, for instance, this leg that Van Phillips really created for himself. Originally, he wanted a running leg, and that became this famous blade. We have taken this technology over to what we call sometimes bionics or active bionics. It is really devices that are powered or enabled through sensoring technology, batteries, and so on. Very, very exciting. And it's among us. It's being used. It's fashion nowadays. It's just cool to show up with a prosthetic device. I've even heard people, kids, say, I want something like that. So it wasn't, again, always like this. Back in Vietnam, we were accused of not taking very good care of our soldiers. That has completely flipped to the other side. Now people like Scott here is flying back his F-16, although he's amputated above the knee and with a leg from Germany called C-leg. We are continuing to pump money and into research. DOD, as well as DARPA, funded a major project here, $100 million, to help people to get back their hands. So, about 5 years ago, 2008, we started turning our head towards people I would like to refer to as the super-enabled, but let's come to that later. As you can see, the prices have jumped staggeringly up to about $60,000, even $100,000 is not uncommon. So like I said, 5 years ago, we turned our head towards the super braves, people who are really outrageous in many ways, and as a result of that, oftentimes end up in a wheelchair. And we are obviously talking about the spinal cord injured. So we thought, okay, if we can do this really for people using prosthetic devices, we can get them even to run in the Olympic Games, why not try to get people to walk out of wheelchairs that are paralyzed? And teaming up with people out in the Bay Area, UC Berkeley, MIT, and others, and New Zealand as well, we were able to finally come up with a fantastic innovation, exoskeletons or bionic suits that we introduced at the TED conference about 2 years ago. This is Amanda Boxtel, who actually sustained her spinal cord injury up in Aspen in Colorado, and had not walked for 20 years until she walked there. So truly amazing experiences and successes. So, but the issue is still the price. $150,000 is the ticket price for one bionic suit. So a pretty expensive car. We introduced this, therefore, first into rehabilitation centers, And the first one was Craig Hospital here in Denver. Absolutely leading in spinal cord injury in the world. And further, this development continues, and we will see these devices get smaller. We can see that here, Parker Hannibald, a major conglomerate, $13 billion company, also pushing forward on this. So we will see these technologies change very fast. It's a whole industry that is forming. From Japan, looks more like Star Wars. But it's actually intended for stroke survivors. And back in UC Berkeley, where we were working, we did this also for soldiers to help them to carry more weight so that they wouldn't sustain injuries. So that was another development. So great, this is fantastic. Success for Paralympians, success for soldiers, and for trauma patients, spinal cord injured. Really, can't say that that this isn't a good start, but it really is a tip of the iceberg. These are the people who need devices simply to live. What about the people who need devices like bionic devices to survive? We have to go down below. We have to look at the masses, which really are the aging population and obesity. We are talking about something that results in osteoarthritis. One out of five Americans suffering from osteoarthritis and therefore have gait issues or other mobility issues. Stroke, 1 million people are paralyzed in this country alone because of stroke. And then diabetics, which I really want to focus on here. 1.2 million people get amputated because of diabetics. One out of every 12 Americans have diabetics. This is going to be one out of every three in 2050. So, what is the issue here? Why can't we get them to walk? Well, it is very difficult to walk on one leg. I was actually thinking about have all of you hop up here on one leg and show me how you do it. It is even more challenging if you're a diabetic. 80% of all amputees are diabetic. Less than 50% of them actually manage to walk. 50% of them lose their other leg very quickly after losing the first one. And finally, most of them die within 5 years because they aren't simply able to turn around their life and... thank you. It's not bionic. and obviously, devices that I was showing you, there's a huge difference between what we can pay for diabetics and what I just showed here before. So this remains non-reimbursable for most. Obviously, because of the healthcare, and our healthcare system is asking more and more, if we try even to put these devices on people, we need some kind of proofs that shows, you know, are these people really more active? Are we really preventing even diabetics? Are they losing weight? So we looked at this, and now kind of with a new team of people, actually here in Boulder, in the epicenter of health and wellness, we are teaming up again, focusing not entirely now on the technology, but more on the journey, that somebody that actually loses his leg because of diabetes or obesity and thinks, okay, this is a wake-up call. I lost my leg. I better do something about that. It's not going to be everybody, but there's a bunch of people out there that come to me constantly and say, what do I do then? And we don't really have the tools or the products to help them. So we have decided to form an initiative that will help people to kind of enter into a program that will give them advice in the beginning before they get fitted with a leg. And these legs will be designed specifically for this population. They'll be truly bionic. It'd be easy to walk on walking feet, not running feet. You just need to kind of get around. Like this foot here, it'd be one of the first ones. It's designed by a local inventor, Jerome Rifkin, absolutely brilliant. And coupled with this, we will offer a coaching program that will be partly online and then offline, where we will give people advice not only on how to walk again, but also on nutrition and other issues in life. Very importantly is tracking and being able to monitor people on a regular basis. So built into these devices will be several tracking systems, but also Wi-Fi weight scales will be used, tracking systems in the prosthetic devices, as well as glucose meters to measure insulin intake, hopefully reduction of insulin intake. So people will go through this program for 4 to 6 months and then enter into life. Further, they will be connected through social media with their peers, family members. My mother-in-law is actually wearing a brace herself, and I'm always asking her, how are you walking with it? And she keeps telling me, yeah, I'm walking with it, but I'm not quite sure. So this would be a way to kind of help a little bit with that. And then patients will be tracked also by the clinicians. They will be monitored, and people are able to kind of give much more a proactive service. Rather than today, it's really like the experience of up and gone, and we never see you again. So it'll be a little bit different. So it's really nowadays about, okay, it's very exciting to introduce a cool technology, but it's not enough. It has to be a couple of dots that we kind of have to add together here, both technology and other programs, to help people to kind of turn around their life for those who really want to do that and create a real sustainable impact with bionic technology. Thank you very much.